Subscribe to our channel by clicking the subscribe button. Click the bell button and enjoy the latest uploads from our channel.
We're back again with another video. iPhone 6S versus iPhone 7 versus the iPhone 8. We revisited the Plus models the other day, and today we're going to revisit the small models, as many of you requested that you wanted to see this video in the form of the smaller versions of those exact phones. So here they are, all looking pretty beautiful, but they're all kind of getting dated when it comes to that design. And that brings me to the first category, which is design on these phones. Let's begin with the 6S, weighing in at about 143 grams. It does have antenna lines here on the rear, reinforced 6000 series aluminum to make up for that bending iPhone 6 problem that many people had. And we did bring 3D touch to this phone here, but overall the design still has the bezels up at the top and bottom. This was more apparent for the white version, and you do have a clicky home button here for this design. So this design was pretty nice, but I think the antenna lines was nicely cleaned up here for the iPhone 7, and I enjoyed that when using this device, is to get, you know, a more clean looking design with the antenna lines gone. If you get a matte black or jet black version of this device, you will have an even cleaner look than the one here on the rose gold. We did bring a capacitive home button, which really made this feel kind of futuristic and made this old clicky home button feel a little clunky. So I do think that the refinements to the iPhone 7 were some of the best made in this generation of phone. Then going over to the iPhone 8, we did have no headphone jack here. We didn't have that on the 7 either. And we did get a glass build to support the wireless charging. And also, I feel like they made this glass build to compete with some of the glass designs that Samsung was doing as well. But some will go back and say, no, they did that with the 4 Samsung copy. We're not going to go through that. The jury's still out on that. Now, the iPhone 8 overall, though, did bring a slightly different camera design on the rear. It did have a little metal strip around it. The flash is quad LED on this one, and it was covered up by glass. So overall, I think the more premium feel of all of these was the iPhone 8, but the iPhone 7 was the lightest here at 138 grams. We have 148 grams here for the iPhone 8. So overall, in terms of design, my favorite one of all these was the iPhone 7, because it doesn't have that fragile glass back. It doesn't have that ugly looking antenna line, in my personal opinion. And also, it just had the lightest feel. So this was the best feeling phone to me of these three right here in my experience. Getting on to display, let's talk about the 6S, which had that Retina display, 326 pixels per inch, but no P3 color gamut here for the iPhone 6. We do have the night shift mode here on the iPhone 6S, which a lot of people think is the same as True Tone, but it's actually not. Night shift changes the blue light so you can sleep better at night and you're not on your phone all night messing with your melatonin level so you can't sleep. True Tone really changes, you know, the colors and the ambient condition of the lighting automatically, so it kind of warms up the display when needed. So that's a way different feature than night shift. But over here, very nice display, just a little bit cooler than these two right here. Those displays got a little warmer, but overall it's about the same sharpness, and I think most people will enjoy the iPhone 6S display even here in 2018, no problem. Now, display over here on the iPhone 7 did get the wide color gamut, and it definitely did look better. You would have to have a good eye to see this, but it definitely had better color calibration than the iPhone 6S. And for photographers, people who take a lot of photos on their phone, the natural look of those photos on this display was really nice. But other than that, there's real no difference, and I don't think most people would even be able to tell, to be quite honest, if you're not pixel peeping and you're not looking for, you know, calibration differences and color gamuts and things like that. Most consumers couldn't tell a lick of difference between any of these. Over here on the iPhone 8's display, you do have that True Tone. And again, this display seemed a little bit warmer than both of these. True Tone comes here. This just changes the color of the temperature depending on the lighting temperature you're in. So that was a nice feature here for the iPhone 8. And I think overall, it gives it the most refined display experience of these three, just slightly, but only slightly here on the iPhone 8. Overall though, you know, after the iPhone 7, this phone was basically the same display with True Tone. So I think over here for the value proposition, the iPhone 7 has the best display. But when it comes to feature rich, then you're going to have to go with the iPhone 8 here. But that brings me on to performance. With the iPhone 6S, you did get an Apple A9 with 2 gigabytes of RAM. And this was plenty enough for the time. And it kind of still is. I mean, if you can see right here, this phone still just flies through everything it does. It works with Apple Watch just fine. Everything just gets the job done here, and it still feels very smooth. So I think the Apple A9 has held up very, very well over this long period of time. Even in multitasking, it's not too bad. Now, where the iPhone 7 did shine was the Apple A10, which is a little bit more efficient, a little bit better on the battery life, in my opinion. Had a bigger battery in here. We'll talk about more about that later. But the iPhone 7 just had more capacitive feel. Like when you would hit the 3D touch, you would feel more of a vibration in this device. And it just feel a little bit more refined. And when you're using like heavier apps, it was a little bit better performing than the iPhone 6S. So it's a pretty happy medium between the 8 and the 6, as I said in the Plus series video. Over here on the 8, very fast, just as fast as the iPhone 10 here on the 8, if not faster in the day-to-day. So if you want the absolute powerhouse, you want the 8. The 8 doesn't break a sweat in anything, and it feels like the fastest phone here. So if you are looking for strictly performance, you want the iPhone 8. This phone is a beast for, you know, having a 4.7-inch screen, the same processor as the iPhone 10, and maybe a little bit less RAM, but it arguably doesn't not need it on the iPhone 8. So iPhone 8 for performance for me. Getting onto camera, there are some strict differences here between the cameras. Now, first up, let's just point out that the iPhone 6S came with an f2.2 aperture, meaning that the lens doesn't open up quite as wide as the f1.8s that is found on the 7 and the 8, meaning low light photos are not quite as good and will produce more noise on an iPhone 6S. If you don't do low light photos in the daylight, these photos are not going to look very different at all. You did get a dual tone LED flash here for this camera. On the iPhone 7, you did get a quad LED, which made your flash photography a little bit brighter. Or if you just like to use your flashlight, it made that brighter. Same quad LED returns here for the iPhone 8. When it comes to the actual camera, though, you do have a 28 or a 29 millimeter lens here on this one. So not quite as wide as the 28 millimeters that were found on the iPhone 7 and the iPhone 8 over here. But that's only 1 millimeter. So you would really have to have a really good eye to see any difference there when it comes to the width. But they're slightly wider on the iPhone 7, just slightly, but you would have to really look closely, like I said. Overall, though, the picture quality is not too much different. I do like how on the iPhone 8, you do get a little vibrational feedback when you do take a photo. And I do like on the iPhone 8 how you get that 4K 60 video recording. That's a monster video recording resolution for a phone of that size. You just don't see that on any phone like the iPhone 8 at this size with 4K 60. I haven't seen it anyway. iPhone SE, iPhone, you could see right there. But when judging just strictly on the camera quality, you don't see that much differences when in good lighting. So when it comes to just photography, these phones never really felt like they really improved that much. I mean, it's not a mind-blowing difference. And for iPhone 6S users, if you've upgraded to either one of these, they probably will also agree that the cameras are not that much better than what they already had. Now, what is that much better is the video has markedly improved over the iPhone 6S if you jump to an 8. Okay, so in settings here, you can see you can record video at 4K 30 on all of them, but you get 4K 24 and 4K 60 for the iPhone 8, which brings you a cinematic resolution at 24 FPS on the 8 and 60 FPS for a very smooth, ultra high quality 4K clip from a mobile. It's not going to be the quality of a real camera, but it's still very nice for a phone. So video is substantially better on the iPhone 8. So if you do want better video, get the iPhone 8. But when it comes to pure photography, I have not noticed really a lick of difference on any of these. I mean, I really was looking like, did it really upgrade? Every time I would upgrade this phone, I would be like, is there any difference? Like, that's how close they are. And I think you'll be happy even now with any of these cameras, quite honestly. Discussing battery life here. On the iPhone 6S, you do get a 1715 milliamp hour cell in this phone. And a lot of people have been having issues with the iPhone 6S this year with the battery. Mine's down to 83, so I'm gonna need a replacement soon for this boy. On the iPhone 7, this one's also pretty low as well. Been using it quite a bit. You can see 86% maximum capacity. And this one goes up to 1960. So the iPhone 7 had a pretty substantial boost when it comes to the size of that battery, over 200 milliamps. Then we go down to 1821. So you might think it's a downgrade going to the iPhone 8, but that's actually not the case. What happened is the A11 processor got so much more efficient than the iPhone 6S's A9 that the battery life on the iPhone 8 is very good. It's actually pretty close to a Plus model. Not quite there, maybe in 30 minutes less, but much closer to a Plus model than these two right here. So this has the smallest battery, but easily the best battery life of all three of these, lasting an easy 30 minutes to an hour longer than the iPhone 7 and the iPhone 6S. So let's discuss their audio experience. So my experience with the 6S has been good through the headphone jack, but not great through the speaker phone from external. So decide, do you really want a headphone jack? Then you might still love the 6S, but that external audio is kind of weak in terms of how loud it gets versus the dual speakers that were introduced with the iPhone 7 stereo sound. One comes out the earpiece, one comes out the bottom. You do lose that headphone jack and you do get your favorite dongle included in the box. iPhone 8 also gives you the same thing as the iPhone 7. You get stereo sound and you do get yourself a, you know, little dongle life over there for the iPhone 8, but the iPhone 8 gets pretty much louder than both of these. And one last thing I want to mention, LTE speeds have gotten better in each iteration. The LTE speeds were slowest on the iPhone 6S. They upgraded here on the 7 and they're the fastest now ever on the 8. So your internet when using cellular is actually quicker for the iPhone 8. Okay, so that's it. iPhone 6S versus iPhone 7 versus iPhone 8 revisited. We learned a lot about what it's been like to use all of these phones here up until this point. I think the 6S has held its own. It's done very well for being this old of a phone now, like 3 years old or something like that, or going on 3 years. And I just think its design is starting to feel old. So, you know, many 6S users might be looking for an update. If you're on one now, I would really just consider waiting until September, or even if Apple drops this, you know, rumored SE2 that's supposed to be coming in June. Over here in the iPhone 7 series, this one, very good still. I think some people might have some battery issues. Go get it replaced for $30 before 2018's up. You should be good for at least a year more or two on the iPhone 7. No issues at all with that one. Now, when it comes to the iPhone 8 is probably the last of this design. So there is something to be said about that. You can say, well, I have the most refined version of that design. If this was your favorite design, you might love using this the long term, but Apple's going to really go away from these bezeled phones. So the iPhone 8 is the one that's going to feel dated the fastest over these two, because you already knew that these phones had this design for quite some time, but the iPhone 8 just came out and it's already going to be replaced with the newer notch designs this year. So overall though, the internal specifications of the iPhone 8, if you got a great value on it, they'll last a very long time. But that design is going to feel like a little bit dated by the end of this year. At the end of the day, I think the iPhone 7 represents the best value here on the table. If you're looking for a cheap phone, the 6S is still better than a ton of budget Android smartphones. It's even better to me than the iPhone SE, as it has a bigger screen, better contrast ratio, and a little bit of a better camera when it comes to the contrast on those photos. Now, the iPhone 8 to me is the best overall, you know, powerhouse phone. If you're looking to buy a newer phone, but you don't want to go the price of an iPhone 10 and you don't want to wait till September, the 8's a good deal here. If you can find it used very cheap, the 8's going to beat both of these phones easily. But overall, the best value here for money to me is the iPhone 7. And that's it. Do you agree with my assessment? Do you disagree? Drop it down below.